which he's going to pay for it. Insurance is going to pay for it. Right. Even having to deal with the insurance is not fun.
Oh, yeah.
Even if they pay for it. Yeah.
I don't like the way. I know.
Right there. Good morning. Let's stand up and worship the Lord together. Here we go. Today I choose to follow you. Today I choose to give my yes to you. Today I choose to hear your voice and live. Today I choose to follow you. As for me and my house, we will serve you. As for me and my house, we will spend our lives on you. Today I choose to follow you. Today I choose to give my yes to you. Friends, welcome to this time of worship at Pathfinder Church. We're glad that you are here as we seek to worship the Lord together. And each week at this time when we start our worship, I always say a word to you. I say something that tries to prepare your hearts to meet with the Lord so that we can dedicate this time as something that's different from our normal everyday life, a time that's holy and dedicated to God. And here's the word I have for us today. It comes from Isaiah. It says this: Lord, you are my God. I will exalt you and praise your name. For in perfect faithfulness, you have done wonderful things, things planned long ago. So here we are in God's holy presence as children of God to dedicate this time as holy and to worship our God together. If you're joining us online, please sing along and please drop a comment below to let us know you're here. Let's worship our God.
Water you turned into wine, open the eyes of the blind, there's no one like you, none like you. Into the darkness you shine, out of the ashes we rise, there's no one like you, none like you. Our God is greater, our God is stronger, God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power, our God, our God. Into the darkness you shine, out of the ashes we rise, there's no one like you, none like you. Our God is greater, our God is stronger, God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power, our God, our God. Our God is greater, our God is stronger, God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power, our God, our God. And if our God is for us, then who could ever stop us? And if our God is with us, then what could stand against? And if our God is for us, then who could ever stop us? And if our God is with us, then what could stand against? Stand against. Our God is greater, our God is stronger, God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power, our God, our God. Our God is greater, our God is stronger, God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power, our God, our God. And if our God is for us, then who could ever stop us? And if our God is with us, then what could stand against? And if our God is for us, then who could ever stop us? And if our God is with us, then what could stand against? Stand against. Our God is greater, our God is stronger, God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power, our God, our God. Jesus, hope of the nations, Jesus, comfort for all who mourn. You are the source of heaven's hope on earth. Jesus, light in the darkness. Jesus, truth in each circumstance. You are the source of heaven's light on earth. In history, you lived and died. You broke the chains. You rose to life. You are the hope living in us. You are the rock in whom we trust. You are the light shining for all the world to see. You rose from the dead, conquering fear. Our Prince of Peace, drawing us near. Jesus, our hope, living for all who will receive. Lord, we believe. Jesus, hope of the nations. Jesus, comfort for all who mourn. You are the source of heaven's hope on earth. Jesus, light in the darkness. Jesus, truth in each circumstance. You are the source of heaven's light on earth. In history, lived and died, you broke the chains, you rose to life. You are the hope living in us. You are the rock in whom we trust. You are the light shining for all the world to see. You rose from the dead, conquering fear. Our Prince of Peace, drawing us near. Jesus, our hope, living for all who will receive. Lord, we believe. Lord, we believe. Lord, we believe. In history, you lived and died. You broke the chains. You rose to life. You are the hope living in us. You are the rock in whom we trust. You are the light shining for all the world to see. You rose from the dead, conquering fear. Our Prince of Peace, drawing us near. Jesus, our hope, living for all who will receive. You are the hope living in us. You are the rock in whom we trust. You are the light shining for all the world to see. You rose from the dead, conquering fear. Our Prince of Peace, drawing us near. Jesus, our hope, living for all who will receive. Lord, we believe. Lord, we believe. Lord, we believe. Lord, we believe.
Amen. Please have a seat.
Right, can we give it up for our worship team one more time, please? All right, good morning. Thank you so much for choosing to worship with the Lord with us this morning, whether that's here in person or if you're joining us online. We appreciate you coming together with us and worshiping God together. And I am going to bring you the things that you need to know about that are going on in the life of our church. And the very first thing that you need to know about is that on Sunday, September 5th, we're going to have a combined service at 10:30 in the morning, so you can come at your normal time, and if you're joining us online, it'll be a normal time too. but that's more a message for the first service people. Next thing that you need to know about is this Friday, we're going to have our final outdoor movie night of the summer. So show up at 8:30. That's when the parking lot will be open. Movie will start at dusk. There's going to be free popcorn, free Freezy Pops, free water. So just bring a comfy chair to sit in, maybe a blanket or two. It's supposed to be a beautiful night. If you have kids in your neighborhood or grandkids or anyone that you know that would enjoy a movie, just bring them on out and we'll have fun together. We're going to be watching Wonder Park. I always forget the name of it for whatever reason. We're going to be watching Wonder Park. And I haven't seen it myself, but it looks like a really cute and fun movie. So we're going to have an amazing time together. Next thing that I have for you is Pathfinder Fantasy Football. I'm going to be starting a fantasy football league for this football season. So if that's something that you're interested in, shoot me an email, shoot me a text message. We'll get you connected for that. It'll be a really fun time. If you have not played fantasy football before, we don't actually play football together. It's just a great time of community where we can check on the players that are doing well and just have fun and maybe have a little trash talk, go back and forth, all in good fun, though. So if you're interested in that at all, please get in contact with me, and we'll get going on that. The next thing that I have for you is that we are starting a Crave Women's Bible Study, and the very first meet and greet for that is going to be August 24th, and that's going to be here at 10 a.m. down in the community room downstairs. If you're interested in that at all, go ahead and call the office, or there's a sign-up sheet right outside at the Connect desk. I believe the book is $9. So if you want to be part of that, I've heard it's really phenomenal. So if you're interested in the Crave Women's Bible Study, I would encourage you to sign up for that. And then the final thing that I have for you is it's time. I wonder what that could be. Let's continue to worship Jesus this morning.
Good morning, everyone. We're almost done with our hamburger of happiness. So I thought I'd bring it back out one more time. Make sure I'm on camera here. Set that right there. So we've been talking about how hamburgers or cheeseburgers bring us happiness and tying that into the Beatitudes. So we're very near the end. And I'm again in Matthew chapter 5. This is verses 10, 11, and 12. So this very top bun, that Beatitude says, "Blessed are those who are persecuted because of righteousness, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven." Persecuted. That's a rough word. That's a hard word to think about. But simply, it means being hurt or attacked, right? So as humans, naturally, when we are being hurt, we naturally feel like we've done something bad. But when we're talking about the Beatitudes and being persecuted, it's because we're doing something that God wants us to do. We want to be like Jesus, be more like Jesus. All of these Beatitudes, we've been talking about how we can be more like Jesus. And so blessed are the persecuted because we are being like God. Now, it doesn't really sound good to say happy or blessed are those that are persecuted, but think about Jesus. Think about Jesus. He was persecuted, right? Yeah. He was persecuted for what he did, but he didn't do anything wrong. He was doing what he was supposed to do. And yet, he was persecuted. And so we need to think about if we follow Jesus, if we do what Jesus tells us to do or what God tells us to do, then we probably will be persecuted. Somebody will blame us for doing something, even if we didn't do anything wrong. Pretty tough to think about. But we know that even if we are persecuted, we'll be in heaven, and the rewards in heaven are going to be amazing. Which brings me to not the icing on top of the cake, but with really fancy hamburgers, you have a toothpick that goes on top, right? Yeah. So this brings me to the end of our Beatitudes. Let me make sure my toothpick sticks into our hamburger, okay? It's not going to fall off. There we go. So it says, blessed are you when people insult you, persecute you, and falsely say things of all kinds of evil against you because of me. And this is Jesus talking. Rejoice. Rewards are waiting in heaven. You can be happy even if you're saying things that people are getting mad about you because you're saying it about Jesus. Does that make sense? I think so. So fancy toothpick for our fancy hamburger. God gives us our toothpick. Think about the most amazing birthday present you've ever gotten. God made something even better, and it's waiting for us in heaven, even if we're persecuted by those around us now. I hope you've enjoyed my hamburger of happiness as much as I have, and stay tuned for some more fun stuff next week. Have a great week.
Where do I buy these hamburgers? Are there Culver's or McDonald's? Not that fancy. So the other day I was out in a parking lot situation, and I saw a penny on the ground. Do any of you actually stop and pick up a penny if you see it laying there? Oh my, okay, me too. I mean, it's like, I was thinking, you know, am I picking up because of the value of the penny or just the principle of not letting money ever go to waste? But also, like, maybe there's some luck in this, you know. But it used to be that this piece of paper right here was once called Mighty, the Mighty Dollar, the Mighty American Dollar. It was a symbol of the power of this this nation. Time has gone kind of not in favor of the value of the dollar. It's more like the lowly penny than it is the great mighty. This is the ticket to everything. I want you to know that when we give of our life, which includes, yes, our money, but when we give of our life, we also sometimes devalue ourselves. Think, well, I can't do anything. I can't do much. Who am I? I'm just, you know. We fail to understand the power of who we are when we give to God of time, of our abilities, of who we just are in presence with people, and even our money. Through the life of our church, we combine together. God can do great things. Let's pray. Thanks be to you, O God, for the wonderful opportunity that we get in giving of ourselves to you and your kingdom. Thank you for the life of this church and for every dollar, for every penny, for every amount of time and effort and energy that each and every one of us puts together to be the family of God, that it is multiplied and speaks volumes as to who we are, but mostly as to who you are, O God. We give you our thanks in Jesus' name, amen.
The memory verse that we've been looking at the last couple weeks is from the book of Hebrews. Let's say these words together. Let us think of ways to motivate one another to acts of love and good works. Let us not neglect our meeting together, but let us instead encourage one another. Let's sing it together.
Let us think of ways to motivate one another to acts of love and good works. Let us not neglect our meeting together, but let us instead encourage one another. Let us think of ways to motivate one another to acts of love and good works. Let us not neglect our meeting together, but let us instead encourage one another.
Remember to turn my microphone on. Good morning, beloved. Good morning to those of you who are out there watching online as well and who are watching later on this week. We welcome you as well. We continue our sermon series entitled, Let's Do Life Together. Let's Do Life Together. And today I want to talk about the role of life together. And I'm going to look at it in a macro sense and then in a micro sense. So at a church-wide level and then at the individual level. All right, and so it's going to be a little bit different kind of a sermon today. I'm going to do a little bit more teaching today than maybe heartstring pulling, but we'll see. Hopefully, we'll pull some hearts too and strings. So the text I'm using is one that you are all very familiar with, I'm sure. It's Acts 2. It is the early church that we see in the book of Acts in chapter 2. And so here's the text. It starts at verse 42. All the believers devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and to fellowship and to sharing in meals, including the Lord's Supper, and to prayer. A deep sense of awe came over them all, and the apostles performed many miraculous signs and wonders, and all the believers met together in one place and shared everything they had. They sold their property and possessions and shared the money with those in need. They worshiped together at the temple each day, met in homes for the Lord's Supper, and shared their meals with great joy and generosity, all the while praising God and enjoying the goodwill of all the people. And each day the Lord added to their fellowship those who were being saved. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God indeed, for sure. So our theme for today is this, and it's kind of got three components, so listen carefully. Life groups provide the kind of life-giving community that transforms and empowers us so that it can impact the world, or we can impact the world. So life-giving community that transforms and empowers us so that we might impact the world. That is our theme for today. And as I said, I want to start off kind of with a brief teaching on the role of life groups to the church as a whole and how we can kind of view life groups. And then we'll look at what kind of life groups there are. And then we'll look at what it means for you as an individual to perhaps be part of a life group. Our friend, Dr. Donahue, again, whose study I'm basing this sermon series on, subscribes to three different theories of how life groups are incorporated into the life of the church. And he uses these three terms to describe them: with, of, and is. With, of, and is. These are important words. They describe the level of group incorporation into the church as a whole. So here's what he means. Here's the first one: church with life groups. And this is the first part. This is a church that has some life groups, but not everyone is involved, and these groups do not permeate all the aspects of church life. Groups like these are essential to discipleship, so please hear that. They are essential to discipleship, but only as non-permanent segment of the church. This could be temporary Bible studies groups, for example. So we have some of those groups like that in our church, and we will continue to do so. And we'll talk a little bit more about those. But these are usually shorter term. They don't permeate the whole congregation necessarily. But they're essential nonetheless. So please hear that. So that's a church with life groups. Now a church of life groups. A church of life groups is everything that you can do in the church has a group aspect or potential for group involvement, and this is much more a church-wide endeavor. So a majority of the congregants or attendees are involved in a life group of some sort, and those groups are involved in the life of the church. So, for example, your life group may choose to serve fellowship time in a given month. Hint, hint. Right? Because I sure miss my cookies and coffee. I keep saying that. All right. So anyway, your life group may choose to serve in some way in the church. Your group may serve as ushers and greeters for a particular month. Or you may serve, at, like I said, serving the cookies and the coffee out in the narthex there or in the gathering area, and so on and so forth. Or your group may decide to conduct a mission project on some sort of mission work on behalf of the church. For example, I know the lipstick ladies under Kathy Davies' leadership there, they have sewn together bags out of old T-shirts and taken those downtown to the homeless so that they have something to carry their stuff in. That's an example of a mission work that a small group does outside of what they normally do in their small group. So there's another example, how the life groups get involved in the life of the church, serving and mission work and so on and so forth. And we have some small groups like that in our church. We have several, as a matter of fact. And this is closer to what we desire for our church as a whole. Life groups that are active in the ministry and life of the church. That's what we're looking for. That's the big thing. And then there is the final level, kind of the upper level, if you will, that Dr. Donahue subscribes to, and he calls that church is life groups. So if you are in that church, you are in a life group, period. And if you're not in a life group, you're not really in that church, okay? So everything you do and can do in church occurs within the life of the group. Baptism, communion, theological training, mission work, everything is involved within the confines of that group. And that's probably a little bit further than we want to go with life groups at this point. Maybe something in the future, I don't know. But it's something to look forward to at least anyway. Truth be told, for us, for our church right now, we are a combination of the first two ideas. When I asked a couple weeks ago how many people were in life groups, about 50% of the congregation raised their hand, which really makes me happy. Okay, I'm very pleased about that. But there's another 50% out there that we could still gather in and bring into life groups. So we are a combination of a church with life groups, because we do have some temporary ones, like our Bible studies and things like that. But then we're also a church of life groups, because we have several of our members involved in doing life together. All right? We desire to be much more a church of life groups. We want as many of you to be in a group together with some other folks as absolutely possible. And I'll share why in just a little bit. So the questions I have for you today is, what type of life group have you been a part of in the past? And so I'll just name a few types, and perhaps you've been a part of these, maybe not. Sunday school is a type of life group that was focused primarily on teaching the Bible. Another group like that is, I know that several people in this church have attended BSF, Bible Study Fellowship. That is another group that is primarily about teaching the Bible, and they're temporary, they're short-term. Our online weekly Bible study is another such group, although mine's not so temporary right now, Christina. We're on week 14 right now, going towards 18, so we've been going for a while. I warned everybody it would be a long one, but we've been teaching, you know, temporary Bible studies throughout the whole year. And those are this kind of group. They're primarily teaching discipleship, and I'm using discipleship wrong there, really, because discipleship is much broader than that. It's primarily about teaching the Bible for those kinds of groups. So you may have been a part of one of those kinds of groups. There are also other kinds of groups that you can be a part of. An affinity group, for example. These are groups that are focused around a common function, or a hobby, or something that the group enjoys doing or has in common with each other. So, for example, we have groups like our sewing circle. They are a group that meet together weekly often, and they sew, and that's part of what they do. And they do life together. They chit-chat during that time. We have our Moms on a Mission, led by Miss Christina, that is an affinity group, where these are moms or grandmoms that have, you know, gone through mothering or are going through mothering and are struggling, and so they they have ways to talk to each other about that. It's a great group. There are other kinds of affinity groups. You could even maybe call the pickleball group an affinity group because they enjoy playing pickleball together. All right, these are affinity groups. There are also groups that are focused primarily on seeing God at work in the world on a weekly basis. These are life groups such as the one that Mary Calder hosts. They are modeled after John Wesley's concept of the class meeting and the band meetings. Listen to those words, class meetings, band meetings. You're going to hear more about those a little bit later on and going on into September, so watch for that. I'm going to be teaching a group here in September on the class meeting concept, and I would like for some of you to join me in that. They're what you call accountability groups, or S3 groups, if you've heard that terminology before, and so on. And if you want to learn, like I said, if you want to learn more about them, I'll be hosting a group here in September, and there'll be more information coming out about that soon. All right, be on the lookout for it. So the question for you is, what kind of a life group have you been a part of in the past? And how about now? And if you've not been in a life group, I want you to ask yourself, why? Why? What might you be missing by not being in a life group? What would hold you back from participating in a life group during the life of this church? I just want you to ask yourself those questions. Why am I not participating in one, and what might I gain, or what might I be losing because I'm not a part of one? Okay? And then the most important question we can ask ourselves about this topic is, what does the Bible say about living together in life groups? It's the most important question we can ask this morning. And the clearest example that I can think of in Scripture is the first century church as described by Luke in the book of Acts. And so here's the first thing. Remember those three things, those three core things in our theme that I wanted you to remember. The first one is life-giving community, and it comes from verse 42 of chapter 2, verse 42. All the believers devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and to fellowship and to sharing in meals, including the Lord's Supper, and to prayer. Four activities are mentioned as paramount to the early church life group of living together. The gospel proclamation, that is the teaching of the Word of God, is paramount. I don't think that should surprise anybody that would be very important for group life together. Teaching God's Word, listening to what the disciples had to say and teach. And the wonderful thing we got to remember is that the disciples, you know, as this early church is forming here in Acts chapter 2, they didn't have the Bible they could open up and start reading from it. They were writing the Bible. They were living the Bible. And they were writing it down for you and me for later on. We're blessed because we've got the Bible. We can open it up and we can look at it and we can see and we can read about the church in Acts chapter 2. But they were living it. And they didn't have a Bible. Now, they had the Old Testament scrolls. But most importantly, they had the teachings of Jesus. And that's what they lived on. And so they shared those teachings over and over and over again. Gospel proclamation, that was the first thing that they had. Then they had this bonding of community, what the early church called koinonia. Koinonia, holding them together, this coming together and sharing in their life together. Eating of meals together, including Holy Communion. Notice it didn't say that they were just having Holy Communion, right? Which in and of itself is awesome, and they should, and we should as well, and we do every month. But it also said they shared meals together, just everyday fellowship meals. And then after that, they prayed together. And this prayer probably refers to the daily prayer schedule, which was three times a day, right, held in the temple. So think about this. This group of folks came together three times a day, every day, and went up to the temple to pray together. And they also had extemporaneous prayer, such as when Peter and John were in prison. We read about that in Acts chapter 4, verse 23 through 31, where the group gathered together and they prayed fervently for the safety of Peter and John while they were in jail. So it wasn't just the organized prayer times, but they also had this time where they came together and prayed for various situations, right? They were doing life together. Life together. And these activities are not unlike many of our own within the confines of our life group ministries. This is what our theme refers to as life-giving community. Life-giving community together. And that leads us to the next part of this theme, which is transformation and empowerment. And that comes from verses 43 through 47. And you'll notice I've just paraphrased them a little bit up here now on the board. It's, you know, a deep sense of awe came over them all. And the apostles performed many miracles and signs and wonders. So there's the first thing I want you to notice. Many miracles, signs, and wonders. And then they shared everything they had. They sold their property and possessions, and they shared the money with those in need. And they shared their meals with great joy and generosity. Beginning to believe we're seeing a theme there, right? Shared. And then the final thing I want you to notice is all the while praising God. All the while praising God. Now that sounds pretty nice, don't you think? I mean, that sounds like a really great situation. It sounds rather utopian-esque, if you ask me. I mean, they shared everything. Money, homes, food, you name it. Generosity seemed to be abounding. And miraculous signs and wonders were abundant. We read about the miracle of the healing that Peter and John were a part of in chapter 4 again, where young man that was lame was lifted up. We hear about Stephen having a vision of heaven and seeing the Lord Jesus sitting at the right hand of God the Father. We hear about Philip, who had a divine appointment with an Ethiopian eunuch. You can read about all of these in the book of Acts in the early chapters. And then he was later translated to an entirely different region instantaneously. He was here 1 minute, and the next thing you know, he's 30 miles up the road. Miracles and wonders and signs. Saul, who later became Paul the apostle, met with Jesus on the road to Damascus. Holy Spirit-empowered works and signs and wonders were the watchword of the day. And guess what, friends? They can be still today. And then quite frankly, they are still today. Our healing prayer ministry on Monday nights have seen miracles happen. We have seen miracles happen, friends. We've been witness to it. A woman who had not stood in 2.5 years, who lived her life in a wheelchair, stood up because Jesus commanded her to stand. A woman who had a cancerous tumor on her liver went in for surgery the very next day that we prayed over her, and the tumor had shrunk to the size of a pinhead. And that's all they had to remove. We have seen miracles, friends. But lest we think everything was in fact perfection, utopia, right? Let us remember that there was some trouble that started to develop early in the church. I mean, you know, the whole thing about choosing the 7 people to serve the widows appropriately stemmed out of the fact that some widows weren't getting the fair share compared to some other widows. You know, compared the Hebrews to the Greek widows, some things were not going right, and so they weren't sharing things equally as equally as that sentence would lead us to believe. And in fact, persecution, which started with the Jewish leaders and then escalated with Saul's tirade against the early Christian community, right? The martyring of Stephen very early on, and we can see that this was anything but utopia. There were struggles. There were frustrations. There were things going on that weren't utopia. But life in the life group was supportive and encouraging. And so much so that even with the persecution, the early Christians were constantly praising God, it says. Constantly praising God. They were transformed into something that could withstand the evil of this world and that could withstand the severe persecution that they were undergoing. And Stephen could sit there as he was literally being stoned to death and say, "Father, forgive them." Transformed into something powerful. Something that could impact the world. And that's the final thing we want to hear out of this theme. It's world impacting. It comes from verse 47 and on. And enjoying the goodwill of all the people. And each day the Lord added to their fellowship those who were being saved. Each day. And they enjoyed the goodwill of all the people. See, the community that was surrounding these new followers of Jesus, the community, that is the people, offered them goodwill. What does that mean? They were mostly kind to the new group of Jesus followers, you know, set aside the Jewish leadership and the church and those that were losing power, right? And set aside the Romans, right? But look at the community, and the community of people saw what these folks had. They looked at this group and they saw the joy that was in their hearts and the sharing that was going on and the upliftingness that was going on, and they wanted to be a part of that. And so they came and they joined them, the ranks in droves, says the Bible, by the thousands. Daily, says the scripture, God added to their numbers. And I want us to remember something. They started with 12 disciples. Friends, don't miss this fact. Don't lose sight of this fact that there were 12 disciples, and I might add several ladies who were disciples as well. It's written in a time where the ladies weren't necessarily lifted up, except for our dear friend Luke, who did so well. But several ladies and these 12, and they became 3 point something billion in our world today. World impacting, friends. World impacting. Don't lose sight of that. 12 disciples, some ladies, and their teacher, who lived life together in a small group for 3 years. And they impacted the world. I don't want us to lose sight of that. Let me tell you a little bit about the life group to which I belong. Okay? Mary Calder is our leader. There's Mary over there. Susie Stewart is her backup. There's Susie sitting right next to her, doing life together. Isn't that amazing? I believe I've told you before that we range in age in our life group from our young 30s all the way into our 70s, and we cover every single decade in between. We need to look for a 20s something and an 80s something for that matter, right? We cover every decade in between. We gather weekly, and at least right now we're gathering at the Stewart household on the lake. And I got to tell you, that's a really beautiful place to gather. Absolutely gorgeous. In the past, we started meeting downstairs in the community room. And then when the pandemic started to get kind of bad, we shifted to outside at the pavilion. And when the pandemic got to its worst, we shifted to online on Zoom. But friends, we never failed to meet. We never fail to meet. Now, sometimes some of us are gone, like I was gone last week because I was over in Detroit. Sometimes some of us are gone, but the group doesn't fail to meet. Sometimes we go on vacation, sometimes there's illness, whatever. But we meet. The group goes on. We love sitting. Sometimes Mike will take us out on his boat, and we'll go out into the middle of the lake. And we'll just sit in the middle of the lake, throw the anchor over, and we'll talk about how we've seen God. Sometimes we sit up on the patio in the back and we look at the swans and the geese and ducks and all that out on the lake. What a beautiful sight. Sometimes we're inside sitting around the table in the dining area. And sometimes we're over on the couches sitting by the fireplace. But we're together and we don't fail to meet. And we enjoy fellowship together, koinonia. Susie often, actually almost always, has a cup of coffee waiting for me, for which I am very grateful. And she often sometimes has snacks as well. Some of us bring our own dinner. Since we meet at 5:30, it's kind of dinner time for everybody. So some of us bring our dinner. Some of us eat just before we get there. Some of us, like I said, we sometimes go for a boat ride. We sometimes sit inside. Just depends. We mix it up, right? Mary and Susie, so that's the koinonia. Mary and Susie usually lead us in a brief 5 to 10 minute devotional, proclamation of the gospel. We never fail to proclaim the gospel in some way, shape, or form in our small group. Theologians like Smith Wigglesworth, who is one of Mary's favorite, and J.D. Walt, who is one of my favorites, are often used for devos. It is not a long teaching, but we never fail to preach the gospel. The primary reason for our gathering together is for each of us to share how we have seen God at work in ourselves and in others since the last time we met. And we go around the table and we just share the various experiences of God that we have encountered. And I want to give you an example of some of the things that we share. So I'm going to share with you the things I shared a couple weeks ago when I was there the last time. So these are some of the things that I shared that night so that you know the kind of things we share. Here it is. I was excited because we have people coming back to our healing prayer ministry on Monday night. We are praying with people again in person, and it is so wonderful to be able to see face to face with someone and lay hands on them and perhaps anoint them with oil. And it's wonderful that we had been meeting with people on Zoom and on phone calls, and we still do if that's what they prefer. But we're also able to meet with people live now on Monday nights. And I was so excited about that. And we got to meet with a gentleman last 2 weeks in a row now that it's just been a wonderful time of prayer for him. I shared that the worship service the week before was filled with energy, and it always makes the pastor happy. When there's energy in the worship service, I feed off of that, and I feel that in you, and it just lifts me up. I shared how we had 14 visitors that particular week in worship. Praise God, 14, and many of them have come back several times, and there's some here right now, and I'm so excited about that. I shared the amazing figures of giving that you all blessed the ministers of this church with that I shared with you all last week during worship, and the surplus that we were able to give to the missions team to support many different local missions this year. And we actually paid them more this year than we have even budgeted for them, because we had a surplus because of your generosity, and we gave them more than we even had budgeted for them. And I'm so grateful for that. Thank you. And I also shared how a particular scripture, 2 Corinthians 5:17, and in particular I used the King James Version for this particular one because it has a word in it that most of the modern translations have removed, annoyingly to me. And there it is. Therefore, if any man be in Christ, he is a new creature. Old things are passed away. Behold, and that's the word that's been removed in almost all common or new English translations, behold, all things have become new. Now, behold, if you look up the Greek word for that, it actually literally means wake up! Wake up! Because something new is happening. And I shared with my group that this was a call to me about revival for our church. That we're going to see revival in this church. And I'm so grateful for that. So wake up, O sleepers, and let Christ's light shine on you and through you. These are just some of the ways I saw God at work in the previous week. And so I wanted to share with you what I shared with my group. So our time together is spent just on that. And then we often end with asking about prayer concerns for each other. What can we lift up to the throne of grace on each other's behalf? We have prayed for our children. We have prayed for our grandchildren. We have prayed for illnesses. We have prayed for recovery. We have prayed for the successful purchase of a home. We have prayed for peace during a run of funerals in our church. We have prayed for job searches. I mean, just we pray for everything and anything that anyone asks. We pray for it. We pray over each other's lives. We do life together. And our church wants the same for every single one of you. Let me finish with this. One of our life group members, who shall remain nameless, had a particularly ugly week at work and had especially had an ugly day the day we actually had met 2 weeks ago. And originally admitted, I just won't go to group tonight. I don't feel like going to group. Had such a lousy day. I won't go. But then decided, no, I need to go. Because I need to hear some good things that have been happening this week. And so came to group. You know, they could have curled up on the couch in misery and self-pity and just sat there commiserating, but instead chose to come and seek God and seek the good that he was doing. And when that person got there, they actually, as they were listening to the good things that had gone on, they actually recognized some good things that God had done in their life that week as well, even as miserable as it had been. If you look for the good that God is doing, you'll see it. And that's what our life group is all about. That, friends, is transformational. From misery on a couch to praising God for what's been done. That, friends, is life-giving empowerment. And that, beloved, is how we will change the world, even if it's just one person at a time. Amen? Amen. Remember our theme. Life groups provide the kind of life-giving community that transforms and empowers us such that we might impact the world. More on this next week. We've got 2 more weeks in this sermon series. Be thinking about joining a life group. You will have an opportunity eventually. Amen and amen. God bless you.
So one of the ways we do life together in this church, and many churches do, we share our prayer cards, the joys, the prayers that we long for each other. And sharing with you through the ones that we had in the first service, Larry Lambeau said a thanks to Brother Don. I don't know, but he also said, put my name in here. But he also said, to all who prepared the food or in any manner contributed to an awesome glorification of a beautiful Christian lady, Marilyn Davis. Yesterday was her service. There's some flowers right behind me there on the communion table that remember this amazing person that was a part of our church family. We had from Vic and Kim Majon a prayer that their son and daughter-in-law, who are most anxious to have a child, that God would make that possible for them to have that child. Sue Roseboom asked us to pray for a friend, a neighbor who's having to go back to chemotherapy and is struggling with her cancer. Billy Andrus asked us to be in prayer for her son, Rick, who has had several falls even this morning, and it's not a good thing in his life. From Sue Ferguson, her sister in Ohio, having a hip replacement this week at the Cleveland Clinic, and our prayers for that concern. Audrey Rowe brought news to us of Jackie Stringham, who used to be a member of this church, who passed away on Friday, and our thoughts with that family. And this morning in this service, we have a card here from Team Green for Rod and Amy saying, please pray for Paxton. She moves back to Concordia University this week, and it is her senior year I'm having to blink at this one because, wow. I mean, the sign of, you know, when you get old, it's like, we just did your senior year, but oh, wait, it was high school. Pray for her safety and her health, and we do. And there's a little heart there. That's from your mom and dad, but our heart's for you too, Paxton. We love you very much. You may have seen a man coming in this morning who looked like he had been in a really big battle and looked a little worse for the wear of the battle. But Paul Stubeld is with us this morning, and this is what he says. A praise and thank you to my wife, Michelle, for all her wonderful caregiving that she has given me over the past several months with all my surgeries. Also, a sincere thank you to our Pathfinder family for all the prayers and support for Michelle and I. Prayers are very much appreciated. Thank you very, very much. And it's just a great joy to see you. Paul had a very significant surgery a few weeks ago. He still looks a little beat up back there, but man, can't keep a good man down. And we're glad to see you this morning. Couple other prayer concerns, and then I'll lead us to the throne of God. One is that I trust some of you will know who I'm talking about. Jake Elzinga has been a significant part in the life of this church, and in my life has become a very dear and precious friend. Jake is at Rose Arbor Hospice, and God is preparing to take him home. And so prayers for Jake and his family. And in just a short while, about 1 o'clock, you're invited, and some of us are going to make a priority to just go across the parking lot over there to the memorial garden that's there in the grass of our church. And we're going to give God thanks for the life of Jeff Farnsworth. We're so grateful for his life. And we lost him a few months back and have not been able to do that time together. So we're going to do that. There's going to be some food afterwards. You're welcome to come and join and support Tracy and her family as we thank God for Jeff's life. Let's pray together, shall we? Thanks be to you, O God, for all good gifts. We deal with a lot of things in our life and our living that come to us, and we're not real thrilled with some of the events and circumstances that come our way. We all have days and sometimes seasons where it seems like an awful lot of things have not come together very well. Remind us, oh God, because we need the reminder that when life is at its toughest, when life is at its moments of deepest disappointment, when life just seems to be filled with frustration and sighs of what else can happen, that God, if our eyes are open to you, if our heart is turned to you, if our prayers are focused, we begin to see and understand that you are at work. And that the toughest, those tough moments in hindsight will be moments where we say, thank you, God. We're so grateful. So hear our prayers this morning, oh God, for people who I've just read cards of hurt and concerns and joys and excitement and expectation for all of life. Thank you, we get to do this together. And thank you, God, for the great privilege of being able to come to you together in prayer. We give you our praise because Jesus made this possible, and we honor him as our Savior and Lord. And in his name, amen.
Let's all stand up and sing together. 3, 4.
Not a warrior, too afraid to lose. I
feeling qualified for what you're calling me to. Lord, with your strength, got no excuse. 'Cause broken people are exactly who we use. So give me faith like Daniel in the lion's den. Give me hope like Moses in the wilderness. Give me a heart like David, Lord, be my defense. So I can face my giants with confidence. He took a shepherd boy, made him a king. So I'm gonna trust you and give you everything. I'll be a conqueror, 'cause you fight for me. Be a champion, claiming your victory. Give me faith like Daniel in the lion's den. Give me hope like Moses in the wilderness. Give me a heart like David, Lord, be my defense. So I can face my giants with confidence. Gonna sing and shout and shake the walls. Won't stop until I see them fall. I'm gonna stand up, step up when you call. Jesus, Jesus, I'm gonna sing and shout and shake the wall. Won't stop until I see them fall. I'm gonna stand up, step up when you call. Jesus, give me faith like Daniel in the lion's den. Give me hope like Moses in the wilderness. Give me a heart like David, Lord, be my defense. My giants with confidence. Give me faith like Daniel in the lion's den. Give me hope like Moses in the wilderness. Give me a heart like David, Lord, be my defense. So I can face my giants with confidence. I'll face my giants with confidence.
Thanks for worshiping with us today. Receive this blessing. May the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God the Father, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all. And all God's people said, Amen.